Loek's all set up. Loek Gijben is going to show us how to use your body as an I.O. system. Thank you, Loek.
Okay.
Big round of applause.
No, not yet. Thank you for showing up. Try it fast. My name is Loek Gijben. I'm a TU Delft certified electronic engineer with a variant in biomedical engineering. And I work for a small company called TMSI. This is not a blatant plug, but if you ever wonder why I'm so biased, you just look up the company and see what it comes from. Oh. This is my wife. She's also an engineer. She's an aerospace engineer. So whatever I do, she always says, it's not rocket science. And she's right. These are my two daughters. I have a personal opinion that there cannot be enough beautiful women in this world. So I tried my best. I have attended Hacking in Progress, Hackers at Large, What the Heck, OM, right now. In short, I'll divide my content in five things. My first thing went off my presentation. The first part is biology. So what's happening inside your body, then interfacing to an external thing. Output and input. Who's here for output? Any hands? Who's here for input? Well, it's about even. And then I'll run out of... See, that was wrong. Essentially, your body is just a big bag of electrolytes, and it's formed in cells. And the major thing that's electrical is that there are ions flowing in and out your cell. Each cell has a potassium-sodium pump, and the way it works, it gets the sodium out and the potassium in, and that's the normal state. However, if you trigger some electric cells, like nerve cells, muscle cells, some cells that belong to your sensory system, is that they are polarized and then they get depolarized very quickly and then go back to the same level again. And you see the long outrun here. Just after a portion is polarized, it cannot be polarized again. So what it essentially means that nerve cells and also a little bit different muscle cells, they have an on-off situation. So you send them, you steer them by pulse frequency modulation. And the max frequency you can have is just after the relaxation period, then you can polarize them again, depolarize them again. Now, this is a picture you probably know. It's a nerve cell like it's in the brain, and then going down through an axon to dendrites where you go to other neurons. If you have an ordinary neuron, ordinary axon, it goes relatively slow. It travels with about 1 or 2 meters per second. However, if you put some myelin on a coating on a nerve cell, then each action potential jumps from one portion to the other. That can go very, very fast. It can go up to 100 meters per second, so you have about 20 milliseconds from your brain to the lower portion of your feet. That's pretty fast. You can model them as a transmission line. That means if your axons are wide, they can travel faster. If they're narrow, they go less fast. When you come to your muscle, then you have from your spinal cord, you have your axon, it goes to your muscle, and then it starts activate the muscles in a motor end plate. So the muscle fiber in itself is get excited, and it spreads along the muscle fiber. If you have a number of muscle fibers that are activated by the same neuron, that is what you call a motor unit. So what it essentially means is that you have your frequency modulation for firing of your neurons, and you have your numbers. The more neurons you fire, the more action you have. Whereas the nerve cells, they work with potassium and sodium as active ions. Inside a muscle cell, it goes slightly different. The motor end plate activates an area that releases a lot of calcium, and the calcium makes it work that the myosin and actin, they act together and they pull the muscle cell to the left. That's strange. Okay, then you have all these ions working in your body. Where do you sense them? Normally, if you start on the outside of your body. Then you have some pieces that work not really well with your signals. Remember the signal that the depolarization cycle was about 100 and or to 120 millivolts, but they don't work together, all together, all the muscles. So when one muscle cell is low, the other is high, so they dampen each other out. And then you also have these layers on your skin, and if it comes from your body, from your brain, then you also have your skull in between, and some inner layers in your skull. Even if you lift your bone, you don't come to the neurons directly. There's a leathery substance that keeps you from all kinds of infections. So it's relatively easy to lift your skull and to put a sensor beneath your skull, but not beneath your leathery substance. Also, there are a lot of blood vessels in your body, and the blood vessels, they conduct the ion flow much faster than the rest of your tissue. So that brings you to the problem that, say, can you see my cursor? Yeah. Say you're in one point on your brain, around here, and you're a little bit inside the twists, and you're firing a neuron there, you can actually measure it better in another place than on the place where the neuron was firing. So that's called the localization problem. You can try to measure it at one point, but you cannot be absolutely sure where it comes from. Also, say if you're firing neurons in your older portions of your brain, or the middle brain, the signal must travel through all this tissue, and it dampens out, and it gets distorted, and it's not that nice signal anymore where it started in the neuron. What clever men have found out is that the outside of your brain is divided in different parts for different functions. Like the backside of your brain, the occipital region, is for your vision. You have your eyes, and then they go cross-linked to the back, and this is the part in the back where you see where your vision is created. On the parietal lobe is where your motor neurons are mostly. So you steer your total body with your movements on about this part. And the front side of your skull is more for reasoning and that kind of stuff. So when we're at the brain, these are the kind of signals you can get from the outside of your skull. And you cannot see anything about it except the frequency and its amplitude. And other clever people have found out that if you're extremely busy, and a lot of different parts of your brain are busy, then you see a lot of high frequency portions in your EEG. A lot of people think that the alpha waves and the theta waves are when you're relaxed. And the theory that I like most is that when your brain is in a relaxed state, the nerve cells, they communicate slowly with each other. And the analogy that I like is that it's like your DRAM that's refreshing. It's keeping your brain at a state that it can remember things. So you see the EEG that has a frequency range till about 150 hertz. And you see the amplitude you measure at your skull. It's 0.0002, that's 0.2 microvolts. And you can also imagine that even the best amplifiers, they have an internal noise level of about a microvolt. So you can ask yourself, how can I measure these low EEG amplitudes? That's why you use evoked potentials. Say you want to measure something in your brain that's related to your motor units. Then you tap a finger, and then a few milliseconds later, that neuron starts to fire because it reacts to your tapping. If you just tap your finger in a regular interval or not regular interval, you can cancel out the arbitrary noise, because arbitrary noise, white noise, adds up to zero, and all the pieces that came from your evoked potential, they add up because they are always in the same delay after the tapping. So that's the way how you can measure EEG at a level lower than your noise level. But still, your noise is important. ECG, your heart. Your heart muscle is a nice muscle because it acts very coherently. All the muscles in your ventricle, they go together, contract together, and that gives a nice heart signal in your body. And EMG is what they say for your stripe muscles. So I can show you something that's, I think that's better. I've hooked myself up. Right now, I'm measuring my EEG, and of course you can immediately see what I'm thinking, or not. It looks very noisy. If I stand still, completely still, you see there are a lot of less artifacts. And unfortunately, one part of my software, well, it is not actually broke, but I forgot to take it with me and I couldn't get the right version together. Because the easiest part to do is you take all these signals and you throw it through a fast Fourier transform, and you get your frequency and amplitude ratio. And normally, if I would close my eyes, then my brain in the back has nothing to do. So normally, you could see if you have enough electrodes in your back, you could see a lot of the you could see appearing more of the alpha waves, the slow waves. I could try it, but I can't see, because when I have my eyes closed, I can't see my own signal. You see any difference? I bet you don't. It's such a noisy signal, you can't tell anything about it right here. Maybe we can see something if I go completely still and I contract my jaw muscles. You see the EMG of my jaw muscles. You see, the EMG is a lot higher frequency than your brain signal is. Also, it's not actually in my presentation, but your eyes, they are the only part, your body parts, they are electrically loaded. The front side of your eyes is positively charged, and the back side of your eyes is negatively charged. And actually, your eyes are a giant dipole. And if you wave your dipole around, you could see some movements. I can try it like this. Wait until it's in range. You see? It's going up and down in the with the movement of my eyes, which is nice if you do, say, you want to investigate sleep, you want to can track your rapid eye movement sleep, your REM sleep with that. So usually you have some electrodes here and here just for your rapid eye movement. Go back to the presentation. Okay, just to wrap up biology, the electricity in the body goes by ions, whereas in conductors it usually goes by electrons, free electrons. Active cell have a peak-to-peak action potential of about 100 millivolts, but when you start measuring on the outside, you're happy to measure 5. The sources of these action potentials are mostly hidden, and the intensity goes by frequency and by numbers. And your nerve system, your fastest nerves, they travel by about 200 meters per second. So you can just put a conducting electrode on the place you like to measure and then amplify and record, right? Okay, let's do that. Let's see if I have my right stuff with me, because no. Well, let's try it another way. These are two metal plates. I put one in one hand and one in the other. See what happens. You can actually see my heartbeat. It's just by two metal plates to your body. Actually, there's a lot of this. If I do my one arm muscle is now in there too. If I put it directly on a nice electrode on my arm, then the EMG goes much better. If I put it on my belly here, then you have a really nice ECG. Well, I'm still alive, I guess. The problem with just sticking two metal plates to your body is... Oh, sorry. Two metal plates and electrolyte. What does it spell? Battery. Inside your body, I'm in an electric field of the mains right now, 50 hertz, and I'm partly connected to the apparatus, partly connected to ground. My body is swaying up and down with 50 hertz with about maybe twofold, threefold, and the things I like to measure in the order of microvolts. So what do? Well, you say you think that my whole body is swaying up and down, but if two points are swaying up and down and I just subtract them, the swaying up and down is not there anymore. You can have parts coming from your body, and that you have to try to get rid of with common mode rejection. And you have ook the outside that's just going to the cables. Besides that, I can show you some other. You also have, I have shown already the interference of other body parts. I had the ECG of my two fingers, and then if I strengthen this muscle, then you could see that the muscle EMG was coming into that signal. You don't want that signal. So that's a source of interference. A bigger one was the movement artifacts. You saw it when I was showing EEG. If I move my head a little bit, then the signal goes away. It goes haywire. So first, the battery. It means that if you have a metal and an electrolyte, then each combination, a metal will lose some ions, metal ions, and they split into an electron, which goes directly back into the metal because it's bound, and a metal ion. But those things, where you have your battery, they give a kind of potential. If you have your potentials high enough, then and they differ high enough, then you can say, let's take an aluminum piece of metal, and on another body part, some silver. Then you can see that you have 1.5 volts offset already in your what you're trying to measure. The small signals you want to measure, you want to amplify. If you have microvolts, you want to amplify it to a few volts, preferably. But then you have to amplify it for 1,000 times. But you cannot do that because your offset is already 1.5 volts, so you need 1,500 volts offset to go with your amplifier, so it doesn't work. So it only works well if your two batteries are exactly the same. So what you have to do is, whenever you put your electrodes on your body, take the same metals. And the nice thing about silver chloride is that you can have them with silver and silver chloride, is that there's a lot of chloride in your body, and if there's a current flowing through your electrodes, then either way, some of the chloride will get off the silver chloride, or you bind some chloride to a free silver ion and you create silver chloride. So what it means is that if you use silver chloride electrodes, you get a nice stable reaction there, a nice stable battery. This is a nice picture. Can you still see my cursor? This is your electrode, and it has an impedance. These are impedances inside your amplifier. If the each impedance of your electrode and impedance of your amplifier, they form a resistor divider. So what actually happens is, you don't, at this point, you don't measure the exact voltage in your body, but you measure it over a divider. The same goes with the other part. If they differ, then the common mode will transform into differential mode, and you cannot get it out of your signal anymore. So what do? You try to make the, back. Why doesn't it go back? So. you try to make these as low as possible. That means you scratch your skin until bleeding. Then you have a good contact. You use an as large as electrode as possible, and then you go into your amplifier and use as high impedance as possible. Okay. Still, you have your 50 hertz coming from outside. Now you have two ways of trying to get by it. First of all, this is the interference getting into your cable. You said, well, get rid of the cable. You just put the amplifier on the electrode. That's commonly done right now. It's called active electrode. There's only one problem, and that's the medical regulation that needs some safety between your the voltage of your amplifier and your body. And it's very, very hard to do. So you hardly see any active electrodes anymore that are medically safe. The other way you can do is to shield your cable from the interference on the outside. And that's how we do it, my company. You take the, if you take the picture on the left, you just have a shield around it. But then there's a capacitance between your cable and your shield. And your inside impedance is very high. And what you now are making is a low pass filter. So you're throwing away all your high signals. If you do it this way, you get your signal from your body, it goes inside, you amplify it once, and you put that signal on the shield. Now the signal from your body is traveling from your body to a snug tunnel, seeing only its own signal. Hi, that's me. And then it goes up to the amplifier without distortion. Almost. Then, what about the other way of measuring then? Can you do dry electrodes? Yeah, you can do dry electrodes without electrolyte, but then it must be purely capacitive. So you put an insulated plate on your skin. There may be even some clothes between your skin and the plate. And then you have an ultra-high input impedance amplifier. But even the ultra-high input impedance amplifiers, they suffer from some things that are called bias currents on the input. And it's a very small current, but you can imagine that if this small current is going here, it loads this capacitor, your capacitor where you're trying to measure with. So what happens after some time, your capacitor is fully loaded and no signal will pass anymore. So what they do, they add an extra resistor here that can drain off all that bias current. But then your input impedance is gone. Also, this capacitor is very, very vulnerable to movement artifacts. You give a yank on that electrode, and then because the system is rather slow, it can take you 60 seconds before the signal comes into range again. So we don't do that. Okay, we don't do that. Movement artifacts. Okay, I'm sorry, I don't have pretty pictures here, but you can imagine that if you have your electrolyte on your body and your metal plate, and you push it on your metal plate, then the electrolyte starts spreading around. The layers of ions may change a little bit, so what happens is the concentration of the electrolyte changes, and the capacitance of the interface changes, because the layer may get thinner or thicker. So the movement artifacts are usually a big problem. So what you do is try to make electrodes that move as little as possible. So wrap-up interfacing. You need techniques to shield your system from mains. You cannot shield your body from mains because I'm connected to mains everywhere. You use the same type of electrodes. On skin, you use silver chloride. What would you use inside your body? Well, preferably something that's rather inert, like gold. Well, I've seen gold turn to purple, to black, to whatever. So it's not that inert as they say it is. But like platinum does really good. Doesn't cost anything either. You want to have a big electrode and low impedance. But what happens if you use a big electrode? You cannot pinpoint it anymore to the right position. So you lose your spatial resolution. And what's most important, if you're measuring, don't move. And the last part, electrodes are always uncomfortable to a certain degree. So I go to output first before going to input. So what can you do with your heart signals, your muscle signals, brain signals, other signals? And then beside the obvious medical reasons, I mean, you can measure ECG, your heart rate, your heart film, and you can see, oh, that's a disease in your aorta or your heart valves are not functioning. But let's keep it like for normal people that are reasonably healthy, and what can you do with it? We start with heart ECG. Okay. It's not that really that exciting. You can measure your heart rate at exercise. That's what you do with your health band, with your tracker when you go sporting. Or you can use it when you're doing neurofeedback. You look at your heart rate and you just try to get it down with just your mind control, as you think. But what actually happens is you relax, you go down, and it can help you relaxing. Yeah. Muscles EMG. Well, instead of detecting a movement, like with video or with accelerometry, you have a G-force meter on your leg, you can just detect the onset, because the moment that the nerve system, the nerve signal arrives at your muscle, you can detect it. So what can you do with it? You can, in medical reasons, it's used for gait analysis, for when people are paralyzed or have a muscle disease and they walk funny, then you can actually see which muscles are used for the movement and at what time they're used. So if you're putting your feet on the ground, maybe you're already exciting some muscles. You can do that for your own training. If you have a difficult movement to learn, you can see the timing for when you use a muscle. Also, if you want to train for, say, tennis, you want to have a beautiful stroke. If you're new at it, you're really tense. You both tense the flexor and the, what's the other one? The extensor, yeah. I'm a little bit ill, so my English is not so good as it used to be. Normally I can make comprehensive sentences, but bear with me. If you want to have a smooth movement, then you only want to use the tensor and not the extensor, because then you get really stiff. So you can use the muscle EMG for training exercises. And what you also do is you can measure the effort, because you see the signal at the motor end plate. You can see that you're really trying. If the muscle isn't moving, who cares? You can see you're trying. So simply said, you can do coordination trainer, if only those things are in the way. Okay, we go to EEG. Now let's see what this not so clever person has to say. I have to jump to second 27. Can you have sound? No sound coming out of mine. Okay. I plugged in the audio cable and it's set to 100. Oh, it's to the different kind of audio. Playback devices. Where are my playback devices? Let's try it again. I'm sorry. I'm a nerd. I don't know how these things work.
So associated with the brain and with the muscles of the face.
Yeah.
So when you wink or smile,
I just do it through the microphone.
And recognizes the behavior you just performed. So when I smile, the wheelchair is supposed to go straight ahead. When I wink with my right eye, the wheelchair is supposed to turn right. And when I wink with my left eye, the wheelchair turns left. Now we'll demonstrate. Turn it on. And a smile. Now blink right to go right. Now blink left, turn back left.
Okay, let's stop him. Actually, what he was saying is, I'm using my brain signals to steer my wheelchair. What actually he was doing, he was using EMG of his muscles in his cheek and his eyes movement, his EOG. So it had nothing to do with EEG whatsoever. And can you imagine this guy? He's going up to his boss he doesn't like, smiling, and then he starts blinking. No. Remember, we want good contact with the skin. Now, some people are just made for this type of measurements, but you can imagine that other people have a lot of problems. So, what you saw in the movie, I have it with me. It's called an EPOC. It's slightly below toy level. And you put it on like this, and it is really uncomfortable. I mean, after 5 minutes, these points start to itch and to really get painful. So the signal quality is, well, it's slightly above toy level. Then you have the ordinary head cap. I have one with me, put the head cap on. You can imagine this is used for, say, a brain sleep disorders. So people get up a head cap, and they get a lot of other sensors, and they're dressed up like Robocop, and then they send home, and they say, you just behave like you would otherwise do. Also, these are done with, these are gel electrodes. So what they do is they yank in a needle and they try to scratch the skin till bleeding, and then they put in gel. And then to a point that your impedance is low. You can imagine if you put off your head cap, it looks like you have just acted in a porn movie. You have all this gel in your hair. So you have to, you really have to wash it out first. So, at my company, you know this guy? It's Arnon Grunberg. 4 years ago, he was at Ohm, and he did a fantastic workshop on social engineering. I told him I was doing these kind of things, and then he said, let's try. I write a novel and record my brain signals, and then 100 other people read what I've written and see if it coincides. Of course, it's totally chanceless. the idea alone is hopeless, but if there's a subsidy for it, then people go ahead. He's wearing this head cap, which is partly my invention, and it's with water electrodes. It has a water felt and a rather wide rubber band, so it will spread the pressure more evenly. And the greatest thing he said is that after a day wearing, his electrodes for his ECG were irritating him more than his head cap. Okay. But then again, the setup was totally chanceless. Yeah, we have another one with a little haircut that is pretty okay. So you just wiggle your electrodes a little bit until you reach the skin. That's what you do. Okay, I think I have to go
Autonomous
to...
Autonomous Labs proudly presents How how to drive with your brain.
How to drive with your brain.
In this video, we're going to show you how to control a car using brain sensors. On the left is our car and laser sensors that provide the car with a full three-dimensional view of its surroundings.
Yeah.
The car drives automatically to the corner. At the intersection, the test subject orders the car to take a right. The car continues automatically. The small frame on the upper right shows the laser sensor readings. The frame in the lower right shows the brain command for the car. After a small delay, the car turns around the corner, as you can see. For our second experiment, we trained the computer to recognize four brain patterns.
Well, you saw his eyes move left to right, so maybe they were actually reacting on his EOG, but for the argument's sake, let's think that he really did it with his EEG after training. What you usually do is you when you look at your EEG, you don't see anything, but you can do pattern recognition. You say to someone, do this and this, and then you try to read the pattern out of it if you do it 100 times. You train it really, really well. So this guy, maybe he trained it really, really well. You could also hear, after a little delay, the car started going right. So it means that the computational burden on doing that is rather high. So let's envision this guy in his car on the road, and he says, oh, I don't have to go to left. Oh, I mustn't think left. Yeah. If you say you cannot think about something, you start thinking about it. So I've sought my butt out on the internet to find the right movie. There's a movie of a guy who misses his lower arm, so he has a prosthetic limb, and he trained it to move it with his EEG, and it really worked. He could grab a cup, and then and a bottle, and then do it in the drink into the cup and drink it. And it looks really amazing. And then off movie, he was asked, and are you going to start to use it? And he says, no. You know why? Because if you want to do it, you really must concentrate on what you're doing. You mustn't think of anything else, or else your bottle will drop. So it's useless to do things like that for steering something with your brain. If it's for a game or so, great, do it. But in real life, there's no purpose for it. There are people that have locked-in syndrome. They cannot move anything. They can't speak. They only have a working brain. You can measure their EEG. I think there are about 100 patients in the world that have that. But even those patients, when they can really be helped with this technique. I don't see them sitting in a car like that. Anyway, the cars drive themselves, so why do it? Okay, what's useful? Now, you can detect alpha waves that you're relaxed. A friend of mine, Danny Audibles, he did a TED talk on where, when you're playing, what's it called, with orcs and elves, you start transforming into an elf when you're relaxed, and you're getting into an orc when you're more upset. Well, that's nice, because your alpha waves, the amount of how relaxed you are, is not something that you can easily detect on the outside. So you can use it with that. And how do you do it? Well, I wouldn't use these things. I'm wearing these special ear grids, and they're pretty comfortable, but not after a few hours. They're not. So what you do is try to use headphones where you already make contact in a place on your head, or maybe in the middle of your head, or glasses. Okay, go to browser. It's, yeah, instruction to self. Okay. A significant number of drops. Yeah, of course. Welcome to the Open EEG. There are, if you want to start doing things like this, you can do it yourself. You can go. There are a lot of sites that have Open EEG and Open BCI. Where's the one? Hardware. This is Olimax. It's not really, if you can try to start with it, but it's not really, really cheap. So if you want to buy cables, contacts, electrodes, all the other stuff. Okay. Other signals. Okay. There's one thing that you cannot put into input or output, but it's called skin conductance. And it what you measure the do is measure the conductance of your skin because your sweat glands are working. So if your skin is wet, I can try to do that. Let's see if it works. Oh, this is my GSR. No, not this one. Let's take a range of 20,000. Okay. What you see here is what's going up and down, and it's going a little bit off limits every now and then, is the amount of sweat that I have on my index finger and my middle finger. It's getting drier, drier, drier because there's a wind coming from the side. Now it's getting wetter, wetter. So what you do is you can see, well, let's see how much impressed I am with the brain capacity of the First Lady of the United States. Okay. Whoa, I'm really impressed. You see it dropping down? Woo! Also, I have 10 more minutes. See, I'm getting out of time. There are also reactions like if I yank myself in the back like this, you see dropping down after a few seconds. It's an autonomous system that works with your glands. You can use this. This is what's used in with Christian Science, with Scientology. They have this apparatus that measures your whatever, your how good you are in following it. This is exactly what it's doing. It's just measuring your skin conductance. So you can use it for a lie detector, but usually lie detectors are totally unreliable, and they use a lot of other parameters as well, like your heart rate and that kind of stuff. But this is very easy to make, and you can use it at home for your lie detector game. You can always say you're lying. You can say, you're in denial, and then the other one says, no, I'm not. See? Yeah. Wrap-up output. The hardware is not cheap, especially the good hardware. The signal-to-noise ratio, artifact ratio, can be very low. So you get a lot of signals you don't have any use for, and you have to try to filter them out. So that needs tweaking. If you're very fluent in MATLAB or LabVIEW, then it's easy to do. And trying to get output out of your body is always why you wonder why you wanted to do it in the first place. I mean, if there's somebody with a big bag of money and saying, I want you to invent this or do this, please take the big bag of money, but it has no use whatsoever. Input. Ah, there's a nice input device. It's single use, I think. there's more input. This is from Homeland. Yeah, you can imagine that if you just put a large current through your head, you can reset a lot of brain cells. I don't know if it's okay. You can have electrical input on your muscles. Anybody tried this? I never have, because They make it look so easy that you're sitting before the TV, watch your favorite soap, and then trying to make a heavenly body just by doing nothing. But it's not really nice, huh? It is. Can you speak up a little bit? I will repeat your. okay, he put it on friends and then put it to maximum and it will cause us burns in 5 seconds. Okay. Buy these, they're really cheap, can have fun with them. Okay, there's an input that's really useful, that's called deep brain stimulation. As you can see, you have two parts of your brain and then you can yank a needle between those halves. So there are parts in the deep parts of your brain that you can use, like below. And some people have found out when they were measuring there that if you have Parkinson, your tremor, then there's exactly the same thing with the same frequency down there as with your tremor. Start stimulating, so that part is not sinking anymore with the same frequency, and your tremor is gone too. You can also use it very well for let's see how a needle is yanked in. I don't think it's going to be done in any supermarket in the near future. But it's good against depression also.
Once the exact nerve cells are located, the recording electrode is replaced with the permanent DBS lead.
Yeah, of course.
Then test stimulation.
I'm a little bit time problem, so. You know this guy? He says he wants a direct interface between brain and computer, and then everybody can just have a brain-to-brain conversation. And he's aiming it to the market in about 4 years, and in 8 to 10 years away, it will be usable without any disability. And it's important to know it heavily depends on regulation. Don't tell me anything about regulations. What he's thinking is totally bogus. I mean, putting electrodes in your head, it is possible, and you can measure something, but where do you put it? I mean, not in your sensory system, because then you have to think, I have to poke to, this is the way how I communicate with my computer. You put it in your front lobe, I guess. But then there's nothing, evolution has taken hundreds, thousands of years to get adapted to your senses. And your brain is fluid. If you have brain damage, other parts of your brain can take over the same functions. But you can never have that, say, my piece of the brain that's doing my hands is taking over my speech. So you probably would have to put a sensor into a little baby. You just take a big saw, open the skull, put the sensor there, so that you can have a baby learn how to work with these kind of sensors. Also, he thinks about the way the resolution is now is way too low. He thinks about 100,000 or a million electrodes. There's only a slight problem. We know need some breakthrough in bandwidth and power consumption. Well, I guess he can try as hard as he can, but he can never beat, what was his theorem from bandwidth? Shannon's theorem. Now let's see. Okay, there's one thing, last thing I will show you because I am running out of time. That you can have direct stimulation. What you do is you make a current source and it yanks some current through your head. And the positive electrode will increase neuroacceptability and the negative will decrease by hyperpolarization. And that actually happens. The only thing is, FDA, there's no scientific evidence whatsoever that it's any use. The EU says it's approved as a medical device for depression treatment. But then, if you see what all the other treatments are for depression, they're hardly effective as any other placebo. And therefore, these things are very popular in sport, because if you think it will work, you start using it. You can make it very easily. I'm getting out of time now? 2 minutes, okay. You can make it easy if you want to ask, stick around and I'll show you something. The regulations, you have medical devices and you have to, for a medical device like the one I have on my side, you have to stick to a certain standard, it's international standard 60601, and it's very, very strict. It's built on the technology of yesterday, so all the new parts are not. There's a loophole, you can try new inventions, but then you have to prove either scientifically or clinically and otherwise that it's safe anyway. And then you need clinical trials and, well, if you yank, it says that if you yank 10 microamps through your heart, it will stop every heart one, every one in 500. So if you have your DC brain stimulation, don't put one on your brain and the other one in your hand, because it will kill you. Then you deserve the Darwin Award immediately. But they say it's perfectly safe, it's like a toy. And so. And there's a new EU directive coming. They say if it looks like a medical device, it does things like a medical device, even if it's a toy, then you must conform to the medical device regulation. There's one loophole, it doesn't count for do-it-yourself things. So you can make your own apparatus without having to comply to the regulations. You may blow yourself to smithereens with it. It's totally legal. Rep input, implantable electrodes, just medical. Muscle stimulation, that's nice if you want to deform your current godly body. And brain DC stimulation, it's an easy do-it-yourself. It has no use, but it may be fun to play with. So what can you hack? If you can afford it, go to OpenBCI, OpenEEG. If not, form a hackerspace that designs a cheaper design. Use techniques for fun, make a game. You can try to make a game that is much, much better than your current... you have a question? Is it time for a question?
Very short question. There's a sect called Scientology. They have an ohm meter they use as a lie detector. So it is a medical device. So you could do something against a sect because you could say, this medical device needs to be abolished.
That is a nice... That's a nice one, yeah. I'm not into politics, but... okay, well, you read the slide. So thank you for attention. If you want to contact me, it's my first name at familyname.nl. And my name was... Loek Gijben.
Okay. Thank you, Loek. Are there any more questions? We still have a little time left for questions. Anyone? Yeah, please go to the microphone.
So what do you think of biohacking? Implants like magnet implants and...
Like what kind of implants?
Magnet implants.
Magnet implants?
Yeah, implants in the fingertips to stimulate the nerves as a sensory input.
Totally harmless.
Okay.
I mean, it doesn't work for a second, but if it's like a placebo is a very, very good thing. If you believe in something, it works. So whatever placebo you use, use it. It's usually much more safer than going to a doctor for medicines.
I can demonstrate it. I've got magnet implants and...
Okay, just stick around. Okay, thank you very much.
Any other questions?
You touched upon the subject of art with Arnold Grunberg.
With?
With the writer. The writer who had this EEG.
Yeah.
And then looking at other people who read that. But have you had contact with other artists as well?
No, never.
No, never.
I'm a hardware guy. I know nothing about the software behind it, or I only know my task was always how to get the signal from your body as clean as possible to a measurement device.
Yeah.
And I was doing my master thesis at the sleep center in The Hague, and there was the neurologist, and he was zooming in on the signal. You could see the staircase of the ADC. So he was basing his treatment on the things that were inside the analog to digital converter, and not on signals that coming from the patient. So I pointed to him, and he says, "No, I can still see some things in it." He was just looking at noise.
Right. Would you mind like talking to me? I'm an artist.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. One more question. This is the last question.
So can you tell me, please? If I lost a limb, for example, but the nerves are still there,
yeah,
is it possible to make a prosthesis which works off the motor nerves, motor neurons?
It's the best way to drive a prosthesis. The problem is that your nerve endings, it's very dense, and you want to have a good signal, so you need wide electrodes The smaller the signal, the worse your signal-to-noise. The slower the electrode, your signal-to-noise ratio goes down. So it's harder to really say something about it. So yes, you can start working with, and it is the best thing to do because you have an electrode on the end of your limb, and then you probably do only the basic movements. Don't expect intricate movements with your artificial hand, but opening and closing, yes.
Okay, that's it then.
Okay.
Look, thank you very much. Let's have another round of applause.
Okay, I will amount.
Great talk.